be lonely this Christmas without you to hold. It'll be lonely this Christmas, lonely and cold. It'll be cold, so cold without you to hold.
There's no sign of Christmas in downtown Tehran. Like everywhere else in strictly Muslim Saudi Arabia, the Christian festival just doesn't exist. Even if it did, the celebrations would be dry, since alcohol is totally prohibited. The kebab sellers still offer delicious slices of roast lamb and chicken to anyone who can afford 3 rials, about 40 pence. Young boys carry crates of exotic-looking birds. Haggling continues, as it always has done, as prospective customers search for a bargain in the carpet stores. Outside, the muezzins still call the faithful to prayer, as they have for hundreds of years. But in spite of the signs of normality, this is no normal city. At the civilian airport close to the town, a massive display of aerial firepower has been assembled. Jet fighters, bombers, attack helicopters, and medical aircraft line the runway, row upon row upon row of them. Yet this is only the tip of a much larger military arsenal which has been assembled throughout Saudi Arabia in response to the Iraqi invasion of nearby Kuwait. America alone has over 300,000 soldiers here. More men and machines are flown in daily on huge transporters. The road north of Tehran leading to the Kuwaiti border has little civilian traffic now, but the rumble of massive military convoys regularly disturbs the hot, dusty air. Turn off the main road and the going immediately becomes more difficult. This is the Saudi Arabian desert, an inhospitable environment which is now home to hundreds of British soldiers. Hidden in the side of a quarry is the administration headquarters of the 7th Armoured Brigade, the Desert Rats, who wear their emblem proudly on their vehicles. Travel further into the desert and eventually you come across one of the units which make up the Desert Rats, the Queen's Royal Irish Hussars, a tank regiment who came to the desert heat from a chilly German autumn. It's a regiment proud of its history, which stretches back through the Second World War to the charge of the Light Brigade and the Battle of the Boyne. The commanding officer is an Irishman who's quick to point out the Hussars' connection with home.
Of course, we've got the Irish name and we've had it since the time of the Battle of the Boyne, the 8th King's Royal Irish Hussars. We've got about 35 to 40% Irish now. In each of the different squadrons, A, B, C and D, the tanks are named after towns from across Ireland, beginning with those initials.
Apart from your own, I say. Now, why is that?
Well, Churchill, actually, there is a wee place in Donegal called Churchill. But Churchill was a subaltern in the regiment at the end of the last century. And then Sir Winston Churchill was colonel of the regiment between 1941 and 1965 when he died.
This is the cutting edge of the Queen's Royal Irish Hussars, the 62-ton Challenger battle tank. It's an amazing machine, very high speed, very heavily armoured, and with a 120mm cannon that can kill tanks up to 2,000 metres away. At £2.5 million each, the regiment's 58 Challengers aren't cheap, but their laser-guided weapons are very accurate, and their armour plating is better than anything they're likely to come up against.
This is the tank we might have to go to war in. And across all the other tanks out here in Saudi Arabia and in Iraq and Kuwait, if you offered me a choice, I'd go to war in Challenger.
And that's not just the official line on these amazing vehicles. It's a view shared by the tank drivers themselves.
It's pretty amazing, like you say. The suspension is fantastic across this country. It's actually made to drive across this country. I really can't say enough about it.
It's pretty hot standing out here in the middle of the day. What's it like inside the tank?
Inside the tank, it's whenever we're not moving, it's really hot. If we're closed down, we turn on our own ventilation system. But driving around is cool enough because you get the air blowing about. But it's very dusty and it does get hot.
Since they came to the desert, the Hussars have been practicing their skills in readiness for any possible conflict to come. They've been on live firing exercises, including this one, where the crews were firing on the move. This ability to hit hard and accurately while travelling at speed will be vital if they are ordered into Kuwait. Most of the soldiers here have been in the desert for between 2 and 3 months. Luxuries are few, but any information about home is eagerly snapped up. Letters and parcels from home do a lot to keep up morale. And perhaps surprisingly, the desert heat is no longer a real problem.
Very warm, you know, getting used to it now.
But cold at night?
And cold at night, you know. It'd be about the hottest day we'd get back home. It's constantly the coldest day we've had out here.
Easily.
And what about the wildlife? I've been hearing stories about all sorts of lizards and scorpions running across the desert.
I'll tell you about that.
It's fascinating. Like, there's a lot of scorpions, but do you no harm. You leave them alone, you know. There's meant to be wild dogs around. Never seen any of them.
I haven't seen any snakes around yet. Just scorpions, not lizards.
Camels, a lot of camels.
I said to the soldiers when we first arrived that I was sure that they would get to know and like this desert and learn how to live in it very well in a short space of time, and that's exactly what's happened. The British soldier is a very, very adaptable fellow anyway, and he's adapted incredibly quickly to this environment.
It's not just the desert environment which can be hostile. If a war does break out, the Hussars may have to face attack from gas or chemical weapons. Under the camouflage netting at the brigade administration area, soldiers are regularly taught how to operate equipment which will give early warning of a gas attack.
We've got the NIAID, which will detect blood, attack concentrations of blood, hydrogen cyanide and nerve, okay? So once these capsules have been broken, it will last for approximately 8 hours, okay? And then we'd have to start going to our mob stocks and getting our refill packs out. Okay, there's a fool's guide inside. I'll give you instructions on how to use the equipment. And on the back is the safety checks you should carry out before using the kit.
All of the soldiers have their own special chemical warfare protection suits and a gas mask. They must be kept with them at all times. A constant reminder of the dangers which could lie ahead. Look flat and featureless. It is in fact a mass of hollows and dips, ridges and crests. And with practice, it's quite easy to hide a squadron of tanks in a very short space of time.
Each crew has a different way of putting up the cam poles, which are the things you see in front of you. And it's a very individual sign of the tank and its crew and the way it works as to how they put up their poles. And I'm sure one of these palmists or something could tell a lot about each crew. Just by the way they put up their cam poles and then the cam.
The camouflage actually looks very effective.
It is, and particularly when you see a whole squadron cammed up, it's very difficult from any distance to actually pick them up. Certainly towards evening and in the early morning, because they do blend very, very definitely into the desert.
And it doesn't seem to take too long to get them undercover.
No, we reckon about 10 minutes to from start to finish to cam up a tank, and probably a shorter time for some of the smaller vehicles.
In the second part of the programme, a typical day in the life of the desert rats and how they feel about missing Christmas this year. Five o'clock on a cold desert morning, and another day begins for D Squadron, the Queen's Royal Irish Hussars. Dawn and dusk are the most likely times for an enemy attack, So for half an hour, the squadron is at stand to, with all tanks fully manned and ready for battle. A cold, wet mist swirls round the squadron as the breakfast cooking gets underway. The chilly morning air takes some getting used to.
Sometimes it gets a bit worse than this. However, it's a bit wet, and as you can see, things dripping from the camnet. And you've got to be prepared for it first thing in the morning when you get out of bed.
Yeah. What time is Reveille normally in the morning?
It's usually about 5:15. It's 6:15, but it varies according to the morning.
Yeah. And what's the routine then?
Just do Reveille, stand to, then we have a breakfast, get washed and changed and all, and then just carry on with normal day.
And then, of course, it gets hot fairly quickly, doesn't it?
Well, around about 9:30, 10:30, starts heating up quite a bit. In the morning, sometimes we'll have to wear a jumper, right, but by that time, you're that sweaty and hot, you just have to take it off. Right?
Did it take you long to get used to the heat?
Well, it did at the very beginning. Yeah. Come straight from Germany, it was hitting autumn there. But once, after the first two, three weeks, were acclimatised, and then it started to get a bit better. Of course, the weather here is getting colder as well, so that helps a lot.
A few miles away, in another hidden location, the soldiers of A Squadron prepare for another day. The cam nets are removed, and the tanks prepare to move out. They're going to replen, army jargon for a refueling stop, during which food and ammunition are also taken on board. As they move off through the morning mist, the tanks are almost impossible to spot in the poor visibility. But that same lack of visibility puts navigation skills to their ultimate test. Fortunately, collisions are rare, but not unknown. There's something eerie about hearing the roar of a Challenger tank only yards away, yet not being able to see it. But slowly, the mist starts to burn off, and the rest of the squadron begins to appear. The armoured personnel carrier converted into a battlefield ambulance, and the armoured recovery vehicle, which is vital in the event of a tank breakdown.
It's 8:45 in the morning. The tanks have been on the go now for about 3/4 of an hour. 1 minute ago, we could barely see the vehicle in front. But now the mist has burned off very, very quickly indeed. Visibility is back to about a mile, and the tanks have stopped for replenishment.
Each tank waits in turn to move up for refueling. A short distance away, there's a grim reminder of the dangers which may still lie ahead. An American field hospital being built to handle possible war casualties. No one here wants a war, but many feel it's inevitable. And if it does come to a fight, keeping the tanks supplied like this will be vitally important.
Tanks roll on fuel, they roll on ammunition, and they roll on feeding the men that are inside them. So my main three things that I have got to get up to the tanks are those items. Fuel, ammunition, and rations for the men. Also, I've got to try and get up to them as well. The things that make life that little bit more livable. By that I mean their clean laundry, the meals from their girlfriends and wives back home, and anything else that I can lay my hands on to make their life more bearable and livable. I do that by, under my command, I have something like 138 men. I have 60-odd vehicles, which vary from 8-ton cargo carrying vehicles to ammunition trucks, to fuel carrying vehicles, JCBs to get it on and off, it's a minimum of without too much trouble, and anything that you can imagine that will carry fuel, ammunition, and rations, I've got it at my disposal here.
There are 58 tanks in the Hussars Corps squadrons. That's nearly £150 million worth of hardware. Transporting them and the equipment needed to service them several thousand miles from their base in Germany was a tremendously difficult task.
Well, it was a tremendous effort, both by the soldiers in the regiment, but also by all those who supported the brigade's move. And that's a very important point, which is often forgotten, because behind us are the logisticians who move us, feed us, and supply us. And they have done a fantastic job supporting this brigade out here.
At any one time, I've got to have on call here 60,000 litres of diesel, which is what I need to keep my tanks running. That could be gobbled up very easily in a day's motoring by the tanks. So I've got to have that. I've got to carry enough rations to feed 652 men for 3 days. So I hold 3 days worth of ammunition or of rations. And I've also have got to have the correct amount of ammunition, and what's more important, the correct type of ammunition, ready available so that when the commanding officer receives orders, he knows that I have got the ammunition back here, ready within 30 minutes striking distance from wherever he is.
Well, that's okay while the tanks are around this area, but what happens if they do have to go up to the border, if they do have to push into Kuwait?
If they have to go north, if push comes to shove, which of course we all hope it doesn't have to come to that, but if it does, I would be 5 kilometres behind battle group headquarters. That is the close, or how close I'm allowed to get. We have worked out is the safe working distance, if anywhere is safe in a conflict. So I will always, and my men will always be about 5 kilometres behind, ready to deploy in any direction or to deploy to any squadron that requires us at short notice.
Refueling is completed. Each Challenger holds 400 gallons of fuel, but in this country, petrol and diesel cost less than half the price of water. Well, now the crews take on food for the next few days, much of it local produce, which varies in popularity.
Cherry drink.
Arab cherry drink.
Lovely. Saudi whole milk.
What about the Arab bread? What's that like?
Not too bad. It's got a funny taste to it, but...
Has it?
Aye.
It's alright when it's fried up with an egg on top of it.
I think it tastes like petrol, to be quite honest. But it's the best they can offer.
The tanks move out once again, but travel only a short distance to their next halt for maintenance. Obviously, in a war, it will be vitally important to keep the tanks mobile. The regiment aims to have at least 80% of its tanks on the road at all times. The squadron artificer is responsible for the servicing.
Well, the tanks have just completed a 3-day exercise, and during that period of time, they cover a large amount of mileage. We're talking about tanks now, since they've been here, approaching a 500-mile point. At this stage, we do an 800-kilometre service, which, of course, is the 500 miles. That's quite an in-depth service, fairly comprehensive. The sort of thing you wouldn't expect to do on your car at that point. We have to remove the tracks, as you can see here. We remove the power packs, that's the engine and the transmission, from the vehicle, and we carry out any necessary tightening of bolts, oil changes, filters, that sort of thing, and generally just check through the equipment. Because it's so complex, it is essential that we do maintenance to that sort of standard. That way we can promote reliability and keep the thing on the road, which is the main aim of our job here today. What we do by having the tracks off here, it gives us access to all the running gear, the road wheels, the drive sprockets, the track pins themselves. It allows us to identify any areas that may need attention, routine maintenance only, really. That is tightening of bolts, that sort of thing. And quite frankly, it's limited to that out here. The tanks fare particularly well in the running gear department here. It's very soft on the running gear, although it's obviously a lot harder on the rest of the tank. But to date, we've been quite pleased with the result. The tanks perform particularly well.
So you're saying it's actually maybe slightly easier on the tanks to be out in the desert than in Germany, for example?
Certainly in some areas it is, in certain aspects. I wouldn't say all. The emphasis of the heat and everything else is put on the electronics to a higher degree, but we don't really encounter any additional problems, just slightly different ones, routine problems, really.
Now, you say you actually take out the power plant, you take the engine out.
That's right, yeah.
And have a look at it and replace it. How long does that take?
Well, we can take the assembly out in about 40 minutes with a slick crew. We generally work on around the hour point. The work itself is quite in-depth and takes a fairly lengthy period of time. We can be working on the pack for up to 3 hours. But generally speaking, we can do the job in an hour and a half, provided we don't encounter any problems. Put the power pack back in, similar time, and be back on the road again.
For soldiers based at the supply echelon, lunch is generally a sandwich or two, but there's always the prospect of something more substantial later on. Generally, the food is given the soldier's seal of approval, even those who live on tinned rations, known as compo, carried in the tanks.
Food, self-catering, and it can be nice.
So it's all in cans, you hear that?
Yeah. You don't get too much sand in it, it's not too bad.
There's plenty of sand in it.
As much sand as you can eat.
Compo's all right, you know, after you've used it for a while, you know, you add your own wee bits to it. Now, what's compo? Well, it's the normal rations that we get in the British Army. At the moment, we've got chicken and brown sauce in here with peas, which is not too bad, you know. But we like to muck around with it. Sometimes, you know, you wash the sauce off the chicken and you fry it up, and then you have some chips with it or something like that, you know. But at the moment, it's just straightforward chicken and brown sauce with palm, which is what we call mashed potato powder. And you get parcels from home or anything like that? I mean, can you supplement the food?
Yes, you can, aye. I've got one on the way at the moment, I hope, from Germany. So we'll see what's in that.
Is that going to be a Christmas special?
I hope so.
Morale is remarkably high throughout the regiment, and a parcel from home containing a new pair of boots is especially welcome.
Oh, that's much better. Brilliant.
Excellent.
The ideal thing. Beats issue.
There's no doubt everyone here would be happier if they had some idea when they'll be going home. And of course, missing Christmas with their families is particularly hard.
What's the worst thing about being out here? Missing Christmas?
Definitely. Missing Christmas. Missing the family as well.
Any message for them back home?
Just hello, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, and don't worry about me. I'm in good hands.
We just want folks back home just to carry on.
That's the fear.
As normal. Because if they say they're having a bad one, then we're going to have a bad one. Yeah.
Well, I'd like to say Happy Christmas to my folks back in Randallstown, and keep up the good work, keep sending those parcels.
That's the important thing, isn't it? Getting the parcels from home, the letters from home.
You can send some to you as well.
There'll be celebrations. We've got one or two little things planned up our sleeve. Obviously, the alcohol is totally out, but we've got a little Christmas tree, an imitation Christmas tree, and I've tasked everybody with buying something. Let it be a bar of soap, a packet of sweets or whatever. And they will wrap it up and just put from somebody on it. And then Christmas Eve, we could well, I think we've nearly arranged that Father Christmas is going to pay a visit. And these will be shelled out the next day, and hopefully that'll cheer them up. But the great thing, once again, about the Irishman and the Irish Hussar is that he'll come up smiling every time. Of course, we'd love to be with our family and friends and children, but, you know, that's our job, and we're here to do it.
The Allies' military build-up in the Gulf is enormous. The firepower available is likely to be devastating, and the general feeling among the Hussars is that it will be used. If there is a war, the commanding officer believes his men will perform well.
There are times when we think we're almost certain to go, and there are other times when we think that peace will prevail. So your guess is as good as mine. I am very confident. I'm sure that my soldiers are. We have a good command structure. We have tremendous allies.